Alright, I accidentally touched a button I wasn't supposed to touch. You guys may notice that the back end is sagging down completely. There's a fault in the air suspension somewhere. My philosophy on these things is if the airbags start leaking, you either replace them with brand new airbags, or you just delete the airbags and go coil springs all around. The current owner, he decided to replace the bags, and there's still a leak somewhere. And for the longest time, like for days, the compressor would kick on, stay on, kick on, kick on, kick on, and got to the point where it just stopped kicking on, and then it would show a service air suspension fault code. The front seat is pretty standard. It feels like any other Panther platform car. And when I say Panther platform, I mean Crown Victoria, Mercury Grand Marquis, Mercury Marauder, that type of thing. It feels the same. But the difference is the dashboard. The dashboard does look a little different. And one of the downfalls of these cars was the lack of technology. And this is the platform that time had forgot. Ford, even in 2007, which was the kind of the last years of these vehicles, they kept pimping out the 4.6 liter V8, 4-speed automatic, rear wheel drive. You know, like the snazziest radio you could get had a 6-disc CD changer in the trunk. Other than that, really, there was no other pizzazz to it. No Bluetooth, no voice recognition, no navigation. Only in the last year of production, 2011, did you get, something's beeping. That's saying one of the doors is open. Only in the last year of production did you get the screen on some of the vehicles, and it was simply just navigation. There was nothing else to it. It was just like one of those old school, like, put the CD in, and then you get navigation. So, but yeah, you can tell here, 545,064 miles. And, you know, this car it's seen some shit. Let's say that. It has multiple misfires. So I had just reconnected the battery because, I was informed that that might be able to help get the air suspension running again. But unfortunately, it doesn't seem like it's able to get it woken up again. I'm sorry, the intermittent door opening thing is kind of distracting. So if I lose my train of thought when it's beeping, forgive me. But even with the multiple misfires, even with the air suspension pretty much sagged all the way down to the bones in the back, and the rear right door, it was giving him problems before, and it's just not the same. It just cannot close properly. This car is still a great car. I mean, through all the crap that this thing has seen, and it's still, you know, there's nothing wrong with the engine or the transmission, as far as I can tell. I'm pretty sure in order to correct the misfire, you just need a set of plugs and coils, because nobody knows the last time they've been changed. And, you know, kind of want to do them every 100,000 miles or so. And this thing has surpassed that 5 times over already. And, yeah, probably it's due for that. And then for the air suspension, just pop in a set of coil springs, bada bing, then you're good to go. You know, as it stands right now with the air suspension not working, it is a rough, rough ride. there's really, you know, nothing absorbing you from the road itself, to the point where it's a little difficult to keep the camera straight. Oh, look at that. It's a 55 Chevy. But when the air suspension was working, this thing was like, it was like driving on air, literally. It was like driving a living room. If you want a vehicle that disconnects you from the outside world completely, a Lincoln Town Car is definitely it. You know, up front, the legroom is still adequate. It's basically the same thing it's been since 1998. It's the same body shell. They've just changed the taillights and the grille and headlights over the years. They changed the suspension a little bit, but even back into the early 90s, most of the Town Cars came with rear suspension. A lot of the Mercurys and some of the Fords also did. A tip for anybody who owns a car with a rear air suspension like these Fords: if you have to change a tire or get the car towed or put the car up on jacks for any reason, there's a button in the trunk, which I forgot to show you the trunk, but it's at least a three body trunk for sure. I mean, this is like the mafia staff car, you know, like you could put four sets of clubs in the back, six people, and still, you know, this thing won't even blink. Anyways, if you do have air suspension, you got to put it up on jacks, or you got to change a tire, you got to get it towed, turn off the air suspension. There's a little button in the trunk that you can click off, and that just keeps the bags from, or the compressor from turning on and filling up the bags anymore. If you don't, and, you know, one of the sensors thinks that that corner is too low, it's going to start pumping up that bag until the point where either it thinks that the car is level, which it'll never be if it's on the back of a tow truck or if it's on a jack stand, or the bag will blow up. One of the two. But these things are pretty much built for highway use. That's probably where most of the miles came from. This thing, when the air is working, it wants to just eat up the roadway. And this thing still gets about 20 to the gallon. And that's with multiple misfires. I think these things have a 327-to-1 rear end. If they do, like the squad cars, then it should get about 20 on average. If it's like a Mercury or a Grandpa Spec Crown Vic, where it's just a highway gear, it'll be a 273-to-1 gear ratio. And that, you should get about 24 or 25 if you really take it easy. So, you know, fuel economy is not the greatest, but it's not bad. And, I mean, what other vehicle can you get this kind of trunk space, this kind of rear seat room, this kind of ride quality, and you know, get anything better than 25 to the gallon, or even 20. It's pretty hard to come by. Not saying it's impossible. I'm sure there's some BMW 7 Series out there that, you know, gets better fuel economy. I'm sure all of them do by now. But, like, in 2007, this was, like, if you wanted to haul people around and you wanted to do it efficiently and kind of cheaply, this was the car. So we're just kind of bouncing down the road now. It's comparing it to that 1980 Lincoln I just drove recently. This thing actually is more, it's a tighter ride. Like, it handles better. The difference between that car and this car, as far as suspension goes, is, well, yes, the air suspension and back, but the front suspension is completely different. It's an aluminum engine cradle, suspension cradle, I mean. And also, it's almost like struts. They're not quite struts, but, you know, the shock and the spring are all kind of one assembly. And it just seems like it's more of a tight, more modern ride than that kind of squishy, old school 70s ride. But other than that, I mean, turning radius is about the same. Ride quality, like I said, is a little tighter. It's a little more modern. But all in all, I mean, it's the same bones, same spirit. God damn, this thing is... It's brutal. It's just... It's like sitting on a waterbed while somebody else is doing jumping jacks right next to you. It's rough. But, I mean, this car's got potential. It needs a few things, and this thing will be a fabulous vehicle. I do love it. I love this car. It doesn't fit my purposes anymore. So, I got the air working on it, so that's a good thing. It was missing one of the hoses, so I just pulled one from the junkyard. Oh my God, look at that. Doors open and everything. I reinstalled all the air conditioning after he put in a new compressor and charged it up, and it was fine. I mean, it's probably not the right way to do it, but, you know, it was free. So, you know, you take what you can get. I don't really have much else to say about this car except that you figure like, oh, it's a luxury car, and this is kind of the best that Ford had to offer in 2007. Unless you're talking like Jaguars and Range Rovers and stuff like that. I'm talking like Ford Lincoln Mercury. And honestly, a 2007 760iL BMW or a Audi A8L or an S-Class long body, yes, they're going to be way more expensive, but they're also, it's going to be a better car overall. I mean, this thing is a great car to me only because I like old school cars. I like column shift. I like a 4-speed or a 3-speed automatic. I like a V8, you know, very simple. But, you know, by the year 2007, you know, you should have put something else in this thing. You know, I don't know, twin or a turbo V6, or, you know, put some more gears in the transmission, at least give it a 6-speed. I mean, fuck. You know, these cars weren't built for performance. They weren't built to compete against, you know, the European and the Japanese luxury vehicles. But they are also much cheaper. So, that's about it as far as the 07 Lincoln Town Car goes. As far as the 80 Lincoln I was talking about in the last video, I didn't really get into the competitors much. And if you're talking full-size, premium quality coupes, Cadillac or GM would have the Cadillac Coupe DeVille, which was a great body of the vehicle. I mean, I would choose probably the Cadillac over the Lincoln, if not for the powertrains that they put in those cars. You know, they put in powertrains like they had the 3.68, the 8.64 motor in 81, where it would shut off different cylinders as you're driving. And, you know, some people swear by it, but most people would say that it was a colossal failure. You know, it was like asking a toaster to play Call of Duty or to, you know, play chess or something. It just, the technology wasn't there to be able to make such calculations on the fly, you know, when to open and close the valves and when to shut off the cylinders and so on and so forth. You had a diesel 5.7 liter 350 Oldsmobile motor, and not entirely, but it really kind of, a lot of it was just, they took a gas engine and they put diesel stuff on it, and they said, all right, that's good. Every 30 or 40,000 miles, you got head gasket problems and stuff like that. Colossal, catastrophic motor failure. You know, they were slower, noisier, smokier, and not really that much greater on the fuel economy. It was just, I don't even want to say a lateral pass. You lost in value when you got a diesel. Fred Hollingsworth, I'm sure you'll disagree, but whatever. And then Chrysler had, so they didn't have a full-size premium coupe. The full-size cars, they had the R-body Chrysler Newport, but only came in a sedan. I'm sorry, the New Yorker only came in a sedan. If you wanted to talk coupes, they had a personal luxury coupe called the Imperial for, I think it was 1981 and 82 only. And that was basically like a Cordoba. It was technically an intermediate. I'm going to stop here for a second before I get gas. It was technically an intermediate. And, you know, both of them were very beautifully designed cars. Like, they had great aesthetics. You know, the interiors were opulent. The bodies look gorgeous, in my opinion. Even the bustle back of the Imperial Coupe. But they were just horribly unreliable in every sense of the fashion. I mean, the build quality was subpar. You know, even brand new, like 6 months old cars, you know, the reviewers were driving these things and they would have shorts and electrical issues and the windows stripping gears and all sorts of weird stuff going on with these cars. And these were like brand new cars. And the problem was, is those, both of those were kind of slapped together last minute. At the time, Lee Iacocca and his team were preparing for the K car, which was going to be introduced in 81. So they had put all the research and development towards that. So there were no more full-size station wagons or full-size personal luxury coupes. I mean, the Imperial was the biggest thing you can get. And it was almost the size of maybe a Coupe de Ville, but it was more like the size of a, it was like in between a Caprice and a Monte Carlo. You know, it was like that weird kind of like 70s intermediate 80s full size. So between the horrible powertrains from the Cadillac and the horrible reliability issues from the Chrysler, I think the town car, if I were to have to choose between an 80 or 81 town coupe, an 80 or 81 Coupe de Ville, or an 80 or 81 Imperial / New Yorker sedan, probably I'd go with the town coupe, just because it's, you know, a 302 or a 351 Windsor V8 with a carburetor it may not be the fastest thing on the road, but we know it works. It works. It'll work, and you'll get 200,000 miles out of it before anything major happens to it. There's no goofy new age electronics or any of that BS. The automatic overdrive transmission it was the first year that they were using that, but I mean, they took a gamble on that, and it paid off, because the AOD, except for in the late 80s when they had the multi-port fuel injection and that little bushing that holds the TV cable in, and the TV cable is basically a cable that as you drive it, as you push the throttle, it pushes in and it changes the shift points in the transmission. And if that gets disconnected, basically you can drive down the block and you'll fry the transmission. And when the little bushing that holds that cable in lets go, then it just drops down, and then that's exactly what happens. So you only started seeing that really in the late 80s when they went from a carburetor.